Welcome to Smith Weekly Discussions, an occasional program for our readers and listeners of Smith Weekly Research. Please note this program is a private discussion and everything contained herein is for entertainment and educational purposes only. With that, we hope you're in a comfortable position, along with your favorite beverage, to enjoy the discussion. We remind our audience to examine the show notes attached to each of our shows to better understand how our program functions. Before we get into our discussion, we want to say thanks for questions coming from our audience at Smith Weekly, including Nick D, at Kunger Trivesh, Paul M, and Jared W. Wayne Heili has joined us today. Wayne is Managing Director and CEO of Peninsula Energy, a U.S.-focused uranium project developer-producer advancing and optimizing the Lance ISR project in Wyoming. The company is listed on the Australian Securities Exchange under the symbol PEN, and also on the U.S. OTC markets under the symbol PENMF. Wayne, thanks for taking the time with us.
It's my pleasure. Thank you for inviting me along.
Well, Wayne, why don't you tell the audience about your background going back before you started spending time in the uranium business?
Well, that would have been college. Andrew, I actually came straight out of college with a degree in metallurgical engineering and entered the uranium production industry. I started my career in South Texas at a uranium mill as a mill metallurgist, and I became a lifer to uranium. I've now been in this industry for well over 30 years, and the progression of my career has been through uranium operations, production, into management, supervision of operations, construction and the design and building of the new facilities, and now as the CEO of Peninsula, I'm overseeing a uranium production company. So it's been a long, interesting 30-year pathway, but I don't have a career before uranium.
So Wayne, you spent some time with some other companies in the sector, including UR Energy. What was learned through the Lost Creek experience, and why did you end up leaving to join Peninsula?
Well, Lost Creek and UR Energy was a very exciting chapter in my life. I had at the time I joined UR Energy, which was around 2007, I had put in nearly 20 years in the uranium industry, and UR Energy came along and had some projects in the state of Wyoming where I live. And, they asked if I would be willing to head up the team or to build a team and head up the project of putting a production facility on the map. So essentially as UR Energy's Wyoming employee number one, I helped the company recruit a team, build a team, permit a mine, design the mine, build the mine, and put the mine into production. That was my ambition at the time. I thought it would be really great after the earlier part of my career to spend some time growing a company and building a facility that hopefully would do well. I think, in the rearview mirror, Lost Creek today is respected as a low-cost production center that has, that has the ability to produce at designed rates and at very low cost. So, I'm proud of the work that was done with the team at UR Energy back in the day. But at that point in time, we had the experience of really having I always say our baby was born into the Depression. Lost Creek, just like any other project, did take an extended period of time to garner our regulatory approvals. And by the time that we had gone down the pathway of designing and permitting and finally building, Fukushima had happened, and the uranium markets had turned for the worse. And despite our ambitions to build a project that could produce 1 to 2 million pounds a year, we found that the market wasn't calling for that production. And I was staring at a future with a company that had one project that wasn't going to go anywhere in the near future. I'm an entrepreneurial sort, and I enjoy the challenges of building and creating. And at that point in time, we said we checked the boxes that we set out to when we started, and it was time to move on. And I didn't go directly into Peninsula, but actually and hung up my shingle and started doing some consulting work for the industry for a couple of years. Ultimately, I did some consulting work with Peninsula that led to my appointment as the CEO.
Well, I appreciate the background there and the discussion on how things went at UR, and sounds like you've spent a lot of time in Wyoming and know that area extremely well. I want to talk a little bit more about just the broad uranium market. What is your position regarding the market today, and how does it look today compared to your experience during the last price ramp up?
Yeah. But oddly, and as I was preparing for this, I looked at the spot market today and the spot price in 2005, which was right before the last run-up. And believe it or not, the spot price today is essentially what it was at the beginning of 2005, which was the start of that bull market and the end of a very long bear market. That's really an anomaly and not a predictor that the market's going to turn for the better in the next year or two. My view on the uranium markets is a very long-term one. If it really goes back to when I started in the late 1980s, the price of uranium in 1988, when I was recruited into the industry, was $16 a pound. In today's dollars, that would be about $35 a pound. We thought supply and demand was a little bit out of balance at the time. It would take 2 to 3 years to correct that. There was an oversupply in the market. 16 years later, with the price dropping down to $10 or even $8 a pound, 16 years later, the price recovered to $16 a pound. So I watched a very, very long bear market during the start of my career. And my perspective on the uranium market is that it's a large, moving ship on the ocean that's hard to turn. Uranium demand, it's very apparent. It's very transparent. You can see uranium demand for years out. It's like the rough waters that are ahead in the uranium market. We can see them coming, and we got this huge ship sailing towards stormy waters, but there's nobody on the boat that knows how to steer the boat clear of those waters. We're all looking at, today, demand being out of sync with supply and supply not meeting demand. But the prices are still very low. And nobody's able to steer this ship clear of the storm. There's people pushing the ship in different directions. Some say go to port. Some say go to starboard. But at the end of the day, the ship keeps sailing straight into this stormy weather of what is certainly going to be a supply shock, just like it was in 2005, 2006, 2007. Where there just simply wasn't enough supply to satisfy the market demand. So that's where we are today. It's very akin to the time leading up to the uranium renaissance period of 2005, 6, and 7. Everybody sees it coming. Nobody knows what to do to change it. It's an interesting time. It's also, a good time for investors when they're on board for this ride. It's a rough ride through stormy waters, but you come out stronger and you come out with, better companies that are well adapted to difficult market conditions. And, today you hear, many, many companies saying, look, we're waiting for higher prices. Our business plan is geared around higher prices. And I agree with everybody who says, we're not going to produce uranium for the spot market price, or really even for the long-term price today. You know, if it's $30 or $31 a pound, that doesn't incentivize new production. So, you know, the uranium market's not fixing. It's not helping us steer the ship clear of the storm. So we're gonna head into the storm, and it's gonna be a fun ride for those who produce uranium. For those who you know, are ready, the first movers, the guys who can act fast when the uranium market goes up, are going to be well rewarded. And I think Peninsula today is in that position. You know, we're ready to act with our projects, and you know, so we're going to take a read of the market. We're gonna position ourselves according to that read, and we're going to be ready for the market when it starts to change.
And Wayne, what do you see taking place with long-term contracting? Do you see something similar to what happened last time? And how long do you think it will last this time as far as the contracting cycle itself?
You know, the wild card in the equation today is that we have the carry trade or the midterm market. You know, what's changed since 2000 is the development of the forward curve. Organizations, good organizations like Numerico, and now, you know, the other price reporting services offer data on a forward curve, and it's essentially a carry trade. You buy, you get a contract for delivery in the next couple of years, and you go out and you buy and you hold that material and you deliver it at a higher price and you make a few bucks. The long-term contracting trends have been impacted by the carry trade because, you know, that really wasn't, we didn't have traders in the market in the early 2000s that were willing to carry inventory essentially for utilities. You know, the utility buyers now know that you know, with a carry trades midterm contract, you know, they can get somebody else to bear the cost of carrying the material for the next couple of years, and they'll just take the delivery on time. So the contracting market has been challenging. Producers need long-term contracts, period. We need contracts that help us build our business plans. Peninsula is fortunate to have some, but you know, that was Peninsula going out in the post-Fukushima market and hustling and securing long-term sales contracts when other folks were saying the prices are too low. You know, now with time in the rearview mirror, we could see that Peninsula's management team did an excellent job of securing long-term contracts, which are a core asset for the company. But going out and getting new contracts today is more challenging. I see that changing. I think it's going to change, and it's going to shift to you know, when security of supply becomes a larger concern. Once supply shock has really hit the market, is when the behavior changes, and security of supply is going to become an issue, and then the utilities are going to turn to the companies that have proven to be a producer, to be a reliable supplier for them, and they're going to be willing to write long-term, you know, 3, 5, even 10-year contracts for supply. Because utilities, by their very nature, have to be long-term planners. And in the last 10 years, I think the trend has been away from long-term planning and towards just-in-time delivery of inventory or supply. So that's shifting, that's changing, and I think it'll change once the market is shocked with an absence of supply. When you can no longer find it in the spot market, you'll start writing contracts.
So in the U.S., the fuel group outcome is likely coming this month. What are your thoughts on this group, and what do you think will come out of it?
Well, as we were, you know, we're recording this, we're really just days away from the nuclear fuel working group submitting their report to the President of the United States. And I've been involved in some lobbying, in D.C. and certainly involved in the crafting of the recommendations of industry trade groups like the NEI and the Uranium Producers of America. I'm encouraged that at this point in time, the industry trade groups are aligned and the recommendations have very strong alignment. The industry, is looking for an impactful change, in the uranium market, which can support domestic uranium production in the United States. Both industry trade groups that I was involved with have recommended, that the government institute some buying programs. I think those are going to be good choices. In the long term, the U.S. government does need to improve its and strengthen its inventory of uranium. It needs to make sure that it has a supply of domestic uranium. And it's probably better for the government to buy a little uranium every year over time than it is to wait 20 years and then suddenly say, where are we going to get this uranium? And we need a whole lot of it. So I see the working group, I can't say what they're going to recommend, but I think that they were receptive to the ideas of some government buying programs, long-term contracts with suppliers, with domestic producers. And today there's really just a very limited number, a small handful of companies that are prepared to turn production on. So there's really a small number of companies that could benefit immediately from the government entering into a supply contracting phase. But I think that's really the best route. It never was the utility's job to save the domestic uranium supply and ensure the national security, which was the argument for the Section 232. I think the solutions of Section 232 were slightly misplaced, putting the burden on the utilities. The solutions that came out of the recommendations and the groups that formed the recommendations for the working group are of a different nature. And you have the entire fuel cycle involved in preparing those recommendations, and they're a set of recommendations and actions that can be implemented to benefit the entire U.S. domestic fuel cycle.
Well, I appreciate your thoughts on that, and hopefully we'll be able to see shortly what comes out of that. I want to switch gears over to another topic, events in the future and potential for oversupply. Do you see that oversupply could occur again by, say, 2030? And in your mind, what events could delay or ruin a rising uranium price environment?
It's going to be really challenging for us to come into a situation of oversupply by 2030 again. I think demand is very transparent, and no matter who you turn to and whose demand model you look at, you see demand growing. At the same time, there's been a dearth of investment into new uranium projects. There's a small handful of companies that have uranium projects that are at the ready and can be ramped up. But if you take most of the free world's uranium developers and you get them all to ramp up to their capacity, you simply won't in the next 10 years come to a situation where you're greatly overproducing. And my view on Kazakhstan, which really was the source of oversupply in the more recent past, is that they're not going to be able to ramp up production largely greater than they have it today. I think Kazakhstan has its production centers producing. Some of them are going to come to their natural end through depletion of the resources, and others will be able to ramp up to displace the loss of productivity from the mines that are shut down because they're depleted. But it's going to be a bigger challenge for Kazakhstan as a nation to take their production from the current level and expand it 25 or even 50%. So, you know, if they could expand it 50%, I'd be, you know, in the next 10 years, I would be surprised. And yeah, folks, you can hold me accountable for that statement 10 years from now if you can find me. But, you know, what I know of the Kazakhstan production capabilities, I don't think they're going to be the source of overproduction in the future. So, you know, it's just really where can it come from? And I don't see oversupply being a big issue in the future. This is that big moving ship. You know, we're moving to a situation of undersupply. We can all see it coming, and nobody knows how to steer the ship clear of that storm.
Right.
The bigger concern is undersupply.
Right. And to get even a potential for oversupply, you first need a favorable price for quite a period of time. So we haven't even got to that yet. And with that, what do you see as the incentive price for uranium to alleviate the demand pressures over the next decade? I mean, what are you seeing out there, and what do you see, Wayne, internally with what you think is really an incentive price to start to really bring on some of that supply?
I'm pretty much with the consensus that we're going to need to see prices north of $50 to really incentivize a strong investment in uranium production. Companies are going to need to be assured that in the long term they can receive that $50 pricing for their production to put their production online. It's a long process. I went through that with UR Energy. You know, we started in 2007. It was late 2013 or thereabouts when we had that mine finally permitted and put online. You know, I don't think there's many places in the world where you can do it on a shorter time frame. I think we did it, you know, pretty well. Peninsula also, you know, took the Lance project from conception to production, you know, in a similar time frame as UR Energy did. You know, that was one of the things that attracted me to Peninsula, was that their pathway was so similar to the path that I was on. It's just, you know, the reality of the situation is we're sitting now in late 2019, and, you know, once you have a market that allows you to make an investment decision, you still need, you know, a long time frame to turn the switch on and have a mine fully ramped up and producing at a healthy rate that contributes to the market. So, you know, that's why I say a decade is a pretty short time frame to be concerned about going from greatly undersupplied to oversupplied.
Well, how about from an investor perspective? How do you think investors should approach this market, and what strategy should they employ to participate in this market?
I've got to look at the uranium renaissance period and the price trends of you know, 2005 to 2007. The change, you know, going into 2005, the price of uranium was $20, and there were a number of companies that were out there, you know, sniffing it out and realizing and seeing it coming that there's a supply shortage. There's a rebirth. We need to produce more uranium. By 2007, you know, emotions had gotten the best of the market, and the uranium price had moved from essentially $20 to its peak around $130. You know, and that was just in two short years. So you have, investors have to look at companies that are ready to pull the switch, the first actors, the companies that are going to be able to take advantage of the rising market. And you know, that's not the Uranium Explorer today. I mean, the Uranium Explorers are going to have some fun with their share prices, and investors will do well with Uranium Explorers. Uranium developers are going to get their development projects going and funded, and I hope for all of their sakes that they don't have the same experience I had with UR Energy and have their babies born back in a bad market, because the timelines it takes to put a mine into production usually exceed the time that the market is good. And that was certainly the case in 2007. You know, so to play the market today, you have to look at companies that are prepared to, you know, to make the investment decision, to pull the switch and ramp up production, and those that are going to be the first to market with their pounds, because they're the ones who are going to, you know, benefit the most from rising prices. And those are the companies that are going to be there in the long term. You know, they already survived this bear market that we're in, and they're going to be the companies that are going to thrive in the next bull market.
Well, let's move over to the company. Can you give the audience an overview of the company in general? Tell us about the management team, capital structure, and the key shareholders.
Yeah, well, Peninsula has a on the ground, a very experienced management team. Obviously, you know, we're a uranium producer. You know, we have a project which we brought from conception to production, and it was put into production in 2015. Today, we're driving production with essentially 2 feet on the brakes. We're not producing any more uranium than we need to satisfy our contracts. But our production team is in place. We have a site manager with 40 years of experience in global uranium production. We have the vice president of geology with a similar amount of experience. We have, you know, one of the best permitting and regulatory guys in the industry today. You know, very highly respected and very effective in his work. And that shows, you know, with the actions that Peninsula has done in the last couple of years. And we have a good, solid operating team. So, you know, on site, our management team is proven and capable. Our board we keep a very small board. We have 5 members on our board. But in that board, we have experts in uranium markets. We have experts in uranium production. And you know, and with people with past experience as CEO and in situ recovery technical, and we have capital markets folks like our chairman, you know, who is a long time you know, participant in raising money for mining companies. So in a very small board, we have all the expertise that you need to run a company like Peninsula. And we actually have it in spades. We have, you know, duplication of capital market strengths with our CFO and finance director. You know, we have duplication in technical leadership, you know, with some of our non-executive directors. And we have duplication in uranium markets experience. So, you know, all in all, a very deep and experienced team, but a small team at the same time. And that's just how Peninsula looks today, and I think we're in great shape to move forward with the team we have. I think the second part of the question is really going to tell us about our share position, our market cap. You know, we have about 250 million shares on issue on the Australian Stock Exchange. Today, our market capitalization is around $50 million Australian or $35 million U.S. dollars. Enterprise value being a little higher, 62 million Australian or 43 or thereabouts U.S. With our share price sitting around 20 cents per share. Our our largest shareholders and for a long time, long-time supporter, Resource Capital Funds, sits with a position just under 10%. Paradise Investment Management out of Australia, a very large and strong resource investor, holds about 10%. And then, you know, beyond those two major shareholders of record, we have a large number of shareholders hold 1, 2, or 3% of the company institutionally, but we've been really enjoying good support in the Australian markets where the company is listed, and you know, our top 20 shareholders hold about 60% of the company.
Appreciate you giving the overview on that and sharing that information with us. What have you done? And I know you guys have made some attempts and done a few things on the G&A side. What have you guys done to keep the expenses cut down during these tough market times? Can you highlight a few actions taken in this regard?
Well, you know, we've never, I guess I joined the company about 2.5 years ago, and we've never really had a large G&A expense in the years following my engagement as the CEO of the company. We keep a small corporate office in Perth, Australia, manned by 4 people. And the rest of our folks are here in the United States, actively engaged in the flagship property, the Lance project in Wyoming. So, you know, we have a small overhead to start with. And we've continued to whittle away at non-essential costs, which is an imperative for any company that's enduring a prolonged bear market. We've reduced our production rates really just to satisfy the long-term sales contracts that we have, so that we're not, you know, producing excess material into an oversupplied market. I think that's the responsible thing to do, you know, for the markets, but also for the finance of the company. And you know, sometimes we're able to satisfy our contracts with material that we purchase in the market, and we've been able to purchase market-sourced material at prices lower than our production costs. So, you know, there again, we get to realize the spread between you know, the low prices today and the fixed prices of our contracts, and that's been you know, good on the revenue side for the company. But you know, I think we've, you know, pushed our overhead costs down substantially, and we've also you know, minimized our production expenditures during this period of the market.
And Wayne, can you share with us where are you guys at with regards to all-in costs? Can you share that with us?
Well, absolutely. And for that, I would like to, you know, rely on the feasibility study, which we released a little over a year ago. You know, we've been gearing our project to adapt the world's leading process chemistry for in situ recovery, which is low pH or acid leach chemistries, and we put a feasibility study out, which really shows that, you know, today with our current production capacity, we could be producing at an all-in sustaining cost of about $40 a pound, the direct production costs around $15 a pound. Of course, we're not producing at the 1.1 million pound capacity of our plant today. We're really idling the project. So, you know, for the most part, you know, our production costs are you know, on the high side of what the feasibility study projects. I think the attraction to this company is really, you know, when we get into the good markets and you know, the markets need greater production rates from U.S. facilities like ours. And if we double our production capacity, which is a modest capital expenditure, you know, and go above 2 million pounds per year, our all-in sustaining costs are projected to be in the $30 price range. And obviously, you know, the markets, in order to incentivize that sort of thing, are going to be well above $30 a pound. So, you know, we could drop our direct production costs down around $9 a pound, and all in sustaining costs in the low 30s, $30 to $31 a pound. You know, that would be optimal for this company. We actually have a licensed production capacity at Lance of up to 3 million pounds. We've built out the capacity at 1.1 million pounds when the plant was first built. So there's a couple of staged expansions planned for the future. You know, a little turn in the market could mean a lot for us and incentivize greater production rates, which we realize the economies of scale and see our all-in sustaining costs drop from around $40 down to around $30.
And Wayne, for the audience that is not familiar, can you give us an update on Lance as to the status, the optimization work that's going on with the low pH ISR method? And give us, for those who don't know or haven't looked it up, has there been some cost reductions as a result of this new low pH ISR method that's being employed?
Well, we haven't started the commercial use of the low pH as of yet. It was the end of July this year that we received the second of the two major license amendments, the approval on the second amendment. You know, we started in 2000 and late 2017, I guess, introducing the notion that we would switch from alkaline chemistry to a low pH chemistry at our project. And fundamentally, you know, about half of the world's uranium is produced with the low pH ISR methodology, and it is the world's lowest cost method of producing uranium. So, you know, we asked ourselves, why are we using the alkaline chemistry when the low pH should be much more effective and cost effective? We went down the path and we led the U.S. industry in the thought process of shifting from alkaline chemistry, which is the way all of the U.S. ISR producers have gone. You know, throughout my career, and we started adopting the low pH. We recognized it would take regulatory approvals, and some people said those would be unobtainable, whatever. But it doesn't matter what they said, because today I sit with the two major amendments that we needed completed. The regulatory work went quite satisfactorily. We delivered the permits on the timelines that we projected. And, you know, as of the end of this summer, at the end of July, we have both of the authorizations to move forward. So now it's really a matter of us making the investment decision to invest the modest amount of capital that it's going to take for us to transition the project from alkaline to the low pH chemistry. And, you know, by that, the feasibility study projected somewhere on the order of $5 to $6 million of capital for the transition. You know, we started doing some of that transition. We did a field leach trial to demonstrate the effectiveness of the low pH. That trial went quite well. You know, met our expectations for the demonstration. But we're still waiting. You know, we have the uranium in inventory and the ability to satisfy our contracts without making that investment. So, you know, we're making that investment slowly over time rather than, you know, making an immediate shift. So we haven't realized the new economics through the low pH, but we have put the project in the position to move forward on a moment's notice with an investment decision.
And what do you think that time frame is going to be once you guys decide to move forward to make everything ready to produce?
You know, I think it'll take us, we'll be able to immediately start mining with the low pH chemistry in the existing well fields, which have not been effectively mined with alkaline. You know, we should be able to, you know, with 2 to 3 months of lead time, be able to start producing again in the old well fields. We need to build some new well fields and put some capital into some new mining areas, you know, to bring us up to full production rate. In that process of developing, you know, drilling and developing and bringing into our license a new well field usually takes a year or so. But we'll be mining in the older areas during the course of that year. So, you know, we'd be ramping up production, you know, from an investment decision, and it's probably 3 months to start the low pH operations and another, you know, year before we can really be producing at a strong license rate.
And Wayne, does that have anything to do with once you guys do this, is there, with the current contracts you have in place, and I want to ask about that in a moment, but with the contracts you have in place, is you guys doing some of this work, is it dependent upon the uranium price where it stands now, or do you guys feel like with the contracts you have that it's really not so dependent upon the uranium price?
Well, in the near term, it is dependent on the uranium price because we have the ability to satisfy our near-term contract obligations through the market and through the inventory that we have today. So it's not an imperative for us to be producing at Lance to satisfy our contracts in the near term. Our contract book does ramp up in volumes, you know, really starting in the year 2021. And we have a baseload volume that would justify the investment decision for higher production rates in 2021 without regard to what market direction is. So, you know, we'll be hoping that, you know, the market is going to support not just producing to satisfy our contracts in 2021, but to be producing for new contracts and producing into a spot price that that supports our mined higher production volumes, because with higher production volumes you get the economy of scale and lower unit costs. So, you know, optimally the price goes up in the course of the next year and a half, and in the year 2021 we're not just producing to meet our current contracts, but we're producing extra volumes and enjoying a more favorable market.
And for you guys going into the market to buy material and deliver to fulfill some of the contracts now, how has that been working out for you as far as availability of material? Have you guys been able to acquire materials at a good price in the market and deliver with no issues so far?
Yeah, you know, this too is a train we saw coming, you know, and when the market was in the low 20s, not too long ago, we entered into some purchase agreements that help us satisfy our contract deliveries, not just this year, but next year. So we have contracted for purchasing some material in the market at prices below $25 a pound, and we have used those purchases in combination with our production to satisfy our deliveries in 2019, and we'll continue to do that in 2020. Today, the market still is wide open. The volumes that we need would be pretty readily available in the spot market or in the midterm market, and you know, the forward price curve is still favorable for us to continue to do that. But there are limitations in our contract as to how much material is open origin and how much is needed to be produced from the Lance site. And you know, we'll respect those clauses, and we'll produce from the Lance site as we need to, and we'll purchase from the market as we can.
Can you give us a little bit more information on the contracting situation as it stands now? So you guys have had some different contracts entered into over the last couple of years. How much of the production, just for the audience who is unfamiliar, how much of the production is sold under long-term contracts? And what does the delivery book look like as far as when that production will be delivered? And can you also highlight for us the pricing parameters that have been agreed to?
Absolutely. You know, we have five sales agreements with the utilities, major utilities, some in North America and some in Europe. And the average, those contracts are not market based contracts, are actually base price escalated. So we can project that the average delivery price will be in the $51 to $53 price range with the escalators in place. Our contract portfolio with these five sales agreements carries through to the year 2030. And it really represents about 30 to 40% of our current production capacity, which, you know, our current production capacity is about 1.1 million pounds per year. So what you're looking at is, you know, starting in the year 2021, we're probably 400,000 to 600,000 pounds per year, depending on the year. Presently, we're only delivering on the order of 200 or thereabouts, 200,000 pounds per year in 2019 and 2020. So these are actually the lean years. Back at the start of 2018, we monetized a portion of one of our sales contracts, and for that monetization, we received $20 million. It's helped us as a company stay out of the equity markets for a long time. I think we used that asset in a very different way, rather than delivering into the contracts, we took cash up front. That meant that our volumes in 2019 and 2020 were lower, and we knew that going in. But that monetization, as I said, it's been a way to use an asset. And I'm earnest when I tell you that our contracts are an asset that this company has that very few other junior mining companies have. You really don't find any other junior mining companies positioned with contract portfolios like Peninsula. That's truly sets us apart. And I don't think the market recognizes it, you know, that we were able to take $20 million in a monetization transaction and avoid diluting our shareholders' interests for the last 2 years on account of that, you know, is quite remarkable and has gone unrewarded. The value of our contract book is hard to understate. We have 6 million pounds remaining under contract to be delivered between now and the year 2030. And, when we can, we'll build on that book.
And Wayne, contracts that you guys were able to secure, who was instrumental in getting some of that done over the last couple of years? Is there some people you want to mention there that helped get that job done?
Well, certainly, those contracts were with the company when I joined the company, and I certainly don't deserve the credit for the contracts. That really goes to the management team that preceded me. The CEO who was dogged in his determination to get contracts when everybody else in the market was saying, now's not the time to be contracting long term because the price will be higher in the future. Well, like I said, with the lens of hindsight, we see that these $50 to $53 per pound contracts are a true asset to the company today. But our board and our past CEO were instrumental in securing those contracts.
And Wayne, I want to switch gears. How is local support for the company and the Lance project? How is the community relations going, and what work are you doing to maintain those community relationships?
Well, our site team has always put a large focus on community relations. We sponsor scholarship programs at the local high schools and attend local government meetings. We're very transparent about our operations, and over time, having a really good environmental compliance record has has led us to the point that the community embraces us as a uranium producer in the area, in the region. When we went to the regulators and we asked for the changes in the license, which would allow us to shift to low pH chemistry at our project, we anticipated that we would have some level of opposition to those changes, but the public comment periods on the two major license amendments went without significant comment, and I think that's a reflection of how well we're embraced in the community. We're trying to be a good citizen in the community. We're active where we are, and the project team has done an extraordinary job of sharing information with the local landowners, with the local communities, and keeping them up to date on the developments of the company. And I think that goes a long way when you're open and available for public questions. I think that matters to the community. And so today, I think we enjoy a very good position in the community, and we're welcome there.
Well, why now should potential investors be considering Peninsula Energy? What would you say to potential investors who are listening?
Well, we all see it coming. I think supply and demand is, and the supply shock is coming right around the corner. There's some great catalysts for the uranium market that should give our company a significant uplift. Those catalysts, could be the outcome of the nuclear fuel working group, but other more shocking catalysts could be trade wars in the U.S. trade wars with China and the potential for sanctions on the nuclear players of Russia and Iran. Today those storylines are developing, but Iran's nuclear program and Russia's involvement in Iran's nuclear program could lead to sanctions on both nations and create a significant supply shock. I think the table is set for the market to turn, and we've all been very patient investors. Those who see the long term know that it's coming. You have to have a long term perspective for an investment in any uranium company, but there's only a very small handful today of uranium companies that are investable. Back in 2007, there was probably 500 companies that you could choose from that could spell uranium and had an ambition to be a uranium producer. Today, there's a list of about 25, certainly less than 30, uranium companies globally, and very few of them are positioned like Peninsula with the long-term protection of a valuable contract book. We have a long-life asset at Lance. We really didn't talk about that, but the Lance project today has the largest defined U.S. uranium resource of any project, and we have a clear visibility to very short timelines to production, to significant production. Our management team has delivered on all of its promises in most recent years, particularly centered around the transformation to low pH. And we're going to be a real cost leader in the United States uranium United States uranium producer utilizing the world's best process chemistry for uranium recovery. So, we've positioned ourselves well. We're production ready. We have low capital requirements. We have ongoing revenues. We have a strong and proven team. And we're using the globally best methods for uranium recovery. Peninsula's a strong company right now in a weak market.
And how can investors reach out to the company and to you for more information?
Well, certainly look up our website, Peninsula Energy Limited. It's an Australian company, and I'm readily available. I'm very responsive to investor questions. Most investors are surprised to see how quickly I'll respond to their questions by email. And I'll make my email publicly available. It is wh@pel.net.au. So investors who've heard this program and are interested in more information may contact me directly. I'll be responsive, and you can also look at our website.
Well, Wayne, let's leave it there. Really appreciate you coming on and spending some time with us to talk about the company, and good luck moving forward.
Thank you, Andrew. It's been my pleasure, and I wish you well in your endeavors with SmithWeekly.